We've got a fair walk and it's a fair way off.
Right, yes.
There'll be a bit more wind than there is here out there.
Oh, yes, a bit, a little bit, but whether it's enough, well, who can tell? But still, the great thing is, it's lovely being out on the shore again, and that's what really counts.
How do the geese come here today?
Well, they'll be too high, I think, but very often on the worst mornings you get a chance, you go out on a splendid morning and nothing comes, you never know. But it never matters to me whether I get a shot or not, as long as we see a few. Well, it's getting light. We're just about in time.
Right. I'll just put this case away off and we'll get off.
Yeah.
Most 72-year-olds would prefer to be happily tucked up in bed on a cold October morning like this. Not Arthur Cadman. A shooting man and naturalist all his life, he still feels the urge to get out on the salt marshes in pursuit of that noble bird, the wild goose. I understand that. Ever since my first wildfowling trip to the north of Scotland, many years ago, I've had reoccurring bouts of goose fever. The eastern farmlands of Scotland, from Perthshire to Inverness, are the winter feeding grounds for huge numbers of greyleg and pinkfeet, which arrive from Iceland every autumn. But getting a shot at them isn't easy. A wild goose chase is exactly that, a very chancy business. But there's nothing like it for excitement.
This point's a very good place, and I think we want one in that channel and one tucked in under the saltings, either there or there, which you take your choice, and I'll go in the other place.
Well, I'll go down in the back. It's easier for me. You don't have to get down on your knees
in there. That's right, and I'll go in there with better cover for honey and myself.
Okay.
Righto. Well, good luck.
There's a whistle if you want me for anything.
Yeah. Here we are, honey. That's a good place for you, isn't it?
Wild geese like to spend their nights on big open stretches of water, like estuaries or lochs or even the sea. Then at dawn, they flight in to feed in the fields. The wildfowler must study their feeding patterns and then try and intercept them along the shoreline or on the salt marshes. But just getting below them isn't enough. You need a bit of help from the weather. The perfect dawn for the goose hunter is one with a freezing force 10 gale and maybe a bit of snow. The worse it is, the better he likes it. For in these conditions, the geese are forced to fly low and he has a chance of a shot. Here they come, but what a height. We've no chance if they stay up there. Don't think we're going to get a shot. Although you keep hoping as every new skein appears. Wildfowling is like that, more blanks than success. We may just as well sit and watch.
I've shot pigeons with this and you stood in the gate and just stood still like that.
Oh yeah, and geese sometimes.
Yeah, pigeons particularly, it's terrific for.
If geese have got their eyes on something, say 300 yards beyond you, other geese on the field, or they're looking to settle, they'll often be very stupid and come right over when, as you say, you're standing bolt upright by gate. But one of the things about wildfowlers today that annoys me enormously is these chaps who walk out onto the mud and they stand bolt upright, and just occasionally they do get a shot with a stupid lot of geese, but 9 times out of 10, the geese shear off, and because they're frustrated, they then shoot at them at 100 yards and wound them. I've seen that happen so often. It's a sign of a really bad, inefficient wildfowler doing that.
Oh, I sat there. It's nice to know when your camouflage is ready.
The flight was more or less over, but it was too beautiful a morning to go home. So Arthur took me on a tour of the Firth. We might find a better spot for tomorrow's flight.
You were talking about the Solway. I knew a chap who'd been coming up for about 10 years.
He's coming back from there now, Arthur, look.
And he never had a shot at a goose, let alone shot one.
20 years some people have been going there.
Aye, well, it's a very pleasant little point, this, when the pigeons are feeding here. They come down and drink. They like the salt. It's a very good point for pigeons.
Where are the seals up here?
Well, at low tide, you'll see them on the sandbanks out there. You can't see them now at high tide.
You've got to be a good naturalist to be a successful wildfowler. You do a lot more watching than shooting.
I think this is more important than the gun, because for a beginner, he's got to spend a lot of time looking and watching long before he lets a gun off to know what he's shooting. And these days, in the old days, of course, it was what's hit is history and what's missed is mystery. But that's not good enough today. With last year's Wildlife and Countryside Act, we've got to have a good knowledge of birds. It's all right to know them in a book, but you never see them like that on the shore. You've got to know their wing beats and their different ways of flying and recognize them. Basically, of course, of the ducks, it's the mallard, widgeon and teal are the three main quarry species. And anything that isn't that, if you're not a good ornithologist, you'd better leave well alone.
There are several species that we can shoot and several species we can't. What are they?
The main quarry ones are grey legs and pink feet. And in the south, the European white front. But the Greenland white front, which occurs in Scotland, is now protected. There's only about 12,000 total population. So one's got to recognise them. Very different call, and that's the way to...
How would you recognise them mainly by the call?
Well, when they're a hell of a long way off, yes. You can... the calls are completely different. You see, a pink is... I'm not very good at doing it, but it's...
Go on, do it for me.
Wink, 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 wink. And the greys are more... And if you hear them going... that means they've seen you.
Is it?
Yes, that's the warning note. Always, if you hear that, you've had it.
When you're out in these wild and beautiful surroundings, it doesn't seem to matter whether you get a goose or not. Just being here is enough.
How many species would you get up here, Arthur? You told me before you used to have some barnacles here up here?
You don't get barnacles here. There were Brent here many years ago. Yes. But they were wiped out by an oil slick in World War I, so I'm told. But when you see geese going like that across there, You can understand how people get goose fever.
Well, I had goose fever. I mean, there's no other excitement like when you've got a skein of geese coming towards you, yeah, and you keep saying, keep coming, keep
That's
coming.
That's right.
Don't deviate, keep coming, keep coming.
That's right.
And then the instant you stand up, you think, I hope they haven't seen me now, and they're just in the right position.
That's right.
I can imagine people going mad over shooting geese.
Oh, God, yes. It's like buck fever with deer, isn't it? Really, same sort of thing.
Right,
but the reverse side of the coin is all these chaps who take stupid shots at geese and wound them. You know, it's a bloody shame, that. And really, that's what a magnum is for. Not to kill a hell of a long shot, but to make quite sure that a fair shot is dead and not wounded. That's the great thing, I think.
We haven't seen any pink feet today yet.
No.
Any up here?
Yes, a few, especially early on. There's always a lot of pinks arrive here first. And then in March, when they're going back to Iceland, then a lot of pinks gather here. It's one of the jumping off points. And you can see a big lot of them. And of course, the pinks nest on the central plateau in Iceland, and that's why they appear first in the autumn and go back last in the spring. The greys nesting at a lower level, they don't need to go back. I mean, they don't need to come here till later, and they go back a bit earlier in the spring. Very interesting the way these things work out. I once saw the most marvelous sight. There was a little lot of pinks migrating, and a peregrine came out of the sky and knocked one out of the middle of them. Wonderful sight.
A peregrine would take a goose?
Pardon?
A peregrine would take a goose?
Oh, yes. Even a grey lag, it'll knock it down.
Will it?
Remarkable, yes. You wouldn't think so.
I wouldn't think
will.
So. The size they are.
Yeah.
You could spend weeks on these firths and never get near a goose. There's just too much shoreline, and you'll need local knowledge of tide and mud conditions. We should have been heading back now, but I wanted to see around the next bay. Arthur said it wasn't worth it, but I insisted. I wish I hadn't.
Getting a bit deep.
Getting sticky.
Hazards of the business, isn't it?
Huh?
That's one of the hazards of the business.
Well, it isn't there, Liver, but I'm not such a bloody fool as I go.
Where it's wet.
That hasn't happened to me once in 20 years.
We got out, and Arthur forgave me, just. But it shows how careful you have to be. Breakfast now, and maybe a little sleep. We'll leave the geese in peace and dream about tomorrow. Our prayers are answered. There's a really good gale blowing this morning. Arthur had made a few phone calls round his neighbours, and here we were on a friend's farm where the geese had been feeding yesterday. I feel really confident today. I think we've got it just right. Every time I come out after geese, I feel confident, and yet I would think I'm successful about one morning in four. There's no doubt you have to be a bit mad to be a wild fowler.
There's some nice bridges here for the lie down behind for me. This is, of course, a job we should have done last night, yesterday. Yeah. And then when you come down, you're prepared so you can get there in the black dark.
Down here is not bad.
It seems all right, Arthur.
Think a wee bit lower.
I can hear them. Here they come. Get tugged down into that grass. They're coming our way. They're still too high, even in this gale. These look better. We could be in business. This is it, straight for me and low. Keep down, keep down. Now!
You missed that one.
I did!
You wouldn't think it's possible to miss geese. They're so big. I think it's because they're big that you think they're flying slowly. Then you don't give them enough lead. Chance for Arthur now. Yes, he's got it. Here we go. It's down. Yes.
Good job. Good job.
Sit.
Arthur, you send your dog for a chat one. She's a good little dog.
No, she's a good little dog. Sit.
dying off a bit now, isn't it?
Your goose?
Yes. Another one. How do you tell a young'un?
Oh, well, that's easy at this time of year. You've got to look at the tails. A really old one has some black marks on its breast, and the tail feathers are coming to a point. You see?
That's an old one.
Yeah, it's an old one. Now, a young one, the tail feathers look ragged. In fact, they're coming to what looks like a W, you see?
Oh, yes, sir. The very tip there.
The tip is straight, and yeah. There's a sort of W. Yeah. And that applies to all geese, all ducks, and all swans, up to a certain time. The mallard are the first to get their adult feathers, as far as I know. And, of course, by January, at any rate, the geese have all got their adult feathers, so it's not so easy that way. In any case, this is a tiny little goose. It's a second hatch. It's not a first hatch, you see.
Much better eaten, though.
Oh, aye. Absolutely.
Much better eaten. Nice,
firm plump. Yes, eat very well.
Good. Terrific. Well, it's been a wonderful morning.
It has been good, hasn't it?
Terrific flight.
Super,
seen thousands of geese. Yeah. Thousands. Amazing places.
We could have shot a lot more if we'd really wanted to.
No, we don't want
to. No use shooting a hell of a lot.
Brace a piece of take home sample for me.
Yeah, one doesn't want to.
Take too long to pluck.
Lovely. Lovely.
That little bit of breeze has just kept them down to a suitable height.
There's a hoop of swans coming over there.
It's an arrow. Yeah. Hoopers over there. Breakfast time. Breakfast. I would agree. Come on, honey.